Hey there, welcome to my first video in a while, and this one is an introduction to microbiology. I'm going to be adding a few videos to my playlist for microbiology. I want to start off with letting you know up front that when I talk about microbiology, I'm always looking at it from a healthcare focus for different kinds of diseases and stuff like that. And then the first question is, what kind of organisms do microbiologists study? Well, microbiologists study small things. Micro means small, and biology means life. And so they study small forms of life. And really what we mean by this is need a microscope. They're too small to be seen with the naked eye. And then to go even a little bit farther, we could talk about the things that a medical microbiologist might be thinking about and learning about. So the kinds of things that can make people sick, what we would call pathogens or disease causers, can be bacteria. Someone gets a bacterial infection. And that is a type of organism called a prokaryote. That means that it doesn't have a nucleus and it doesn't have things like mitochondria or Golgi bodies or endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, then all the rest of them are eukaryotes. So you've got fungus. Those can cause infection. And like if someone gets a yeast infection, or maybe you've heard of like thrush or candida, those are yeast. Then protists can cause disease. And these are single-celled organisms. They actually are super varied, and I'm going to talk more about them down below. But they are eukaryotes, even though they're single-celled like bacteria. And then helminths, that's kind of a fancy way of saying worms. And when we're talking about medical microbiology, we are not talking about earthworms, we are talking about parasitic worms. And then I'm going to use a different color altogether to list viruses, because viruses tend to be considered not alive because they can't reproduce on their own. They aren't able to do their own metabolism. They don't have their own cell membrane, etc. So viruses are considered non-cellular altogether, whereas all of the other things, there's no debate that all of these are alive. So then the other thing I want to put here is then that these ones are prokaryotes, which I know we already wrote that, but we're doing it again, prokaryotes, and all the rest of these are eukaryotes. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about the way that these different kinds of organisms are grouped. So we'll move down a little bit, and I'm going to talk about basically two domains and, or three domains, I guess, and then six groupings. So let's use this. So question number two. Is how are these alike? And how are they different? What is the difference between getting a fungal infection and getting a bacterial infection, for example? So if we put these into some big groups, then let's start with viruses over here, just so that we have them on the list. And then next, you could put bacteria, and actually I'm going to write that in pink. I'm going to do a different color for each of these. And then purple, protist. And then blue, fungi, green plants. And notice I didn't talk about plants making us sick. It's not exactly something that would be considered pathogenic, although I have read some pretty good novels where the plants attack. Okay, animals. I suppose sometimes people have like something grow in their body from a plant. That would be kind of unusual though. Okay, so I'm kind of grouping them like this, and I even want to put a disclaimer here. I've put off doing this video because classification is highly controversial, and I really didn't want to get into debates about that. So classification systems vary depending on what book you read and who you talk to. So I'm looking for general trends to teach beginners. And I'm not relying on domains or even kingdoms anymore, because believe it or not, even just the kingdoms of life and the domains are debated. So for our purposes, we really just want to talk about what are some examples of these types of things that could cause disease in humans. Okay, so with viruses, we already said that they are non-cellular. And then we could list some viruses as examples. For example, herpes virus or varicella, which is the virus that can cause chickenpox and shingles. Or we could talk about HIV or measles. So these are some examples of viruses. Oh, maybe hepatitis B would be a good one to put on here. And we have vaccinations to some of these diseases. Okay, so then these are non-cellular. And then bacteria, remember I said that these are prokaryotic. And in my next video, I'm going to go through, sort of review for you the differences between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. And then all of the rest of these are considered eukaryotes, which means whether they are one cell or multicellular, they are going to have a nucleus, they're going to have organelles. So that's the first big thing I wanted to say about them. So you can see that that is some things here that are similar for most of them. And then the prokaryotes are different because they don't have a nucleus, and viruses are different than that even because they are not considered to be of cellular origin. Okay, so then next, let's talk about how many cells they usually come in. So I was saying viruses are non-cellular. Bacteria are unicellular, so there might be billions of them that are living near each other, but they are not considered to be working together in such a way as to be a multicellular organism. Protists are unicellular. That would be like if you've ever heard of amoebas and like entamoebic dysentery. Fungus, it depends. So yeast can be unicellular, and that's typically the kind that cause disease, but they can also be multicellular, like for example, a mushroom. But for our purposes, unicellular is typically what we find in the ones that cause disease in humans. Plants are multicellular. And you probably guessed already, animals are very multicellular. The next comparison I want to make is whether or not they have a cell membrane. So here we go again. Viruses are non-cellular, therefore they do not have a cell membrane. Every living thing, though, does have a cell membrane. So this is something that they all have in common. And actually part of what fits with our definition of whether something is considered alive or not. However, they do not all have another layer called a cell wall. So I'm going to do that one in green. So if you think about it, then you can sort of imagine it makes sense that plants have not just a squishy, lipidy cell membrane, but they also have a rigid cell wall. That's what gives them the strength to stand up. And if you think about a mushroom, you might agree that it makes sense that it would have a cell wall because a mushroom can sort of stand up and has a stalk. Bacteria also always have cell walls. We'll be learning a lot about the structure of the cell wall of bacteria in this class and how we use antibiotics to target that a lot of times. Now you see what you're left with are the squishy protists and the animals. They do not have a cell wall. So I'm writing it like this, and then I'm going, no, 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 they do not have a cell wall. It's absent. But this one does, and this one does, and plants do. Okay, the next thing that I will compare is some of the different diseases that can be caused. So I'm going to give you some names. I guess I did right here for viruses already. And then for bacteria, you've maybe heard of Staphylococcus. And I did these in purple on purpose. They are gram-positive. They sometimes form in clusters. That's what staphyl means. And then Streptococcus means that they form in chains. And the word coccus means a sphere. And strepto means chain. Sorry, that should say chain. And staphyl means cluster. So staphylococcus are these clusters of spheres, and streptococcus are chains of spheres. And maybe you've heard of staph infections and strep infections. Okay, then protists. Plasmodium is the organism that causes malaria. Entamoeba can cause a terrible dysentery, meaning a terrible diarrhea. And Giardia is another protist that's actually found in the temperate Northwest, where I live, and that is causes diarrhea too, and it can live in like cool water creeks where beavers and things like that have gone to the bathroom. Then the good examples for fungus are Candida albicans that causes thrush, and then a variety of other yeast that can cause just generically what we call yeast infections. I won't list all the species names. And then once in a while, you'll just hear them all grouped as dermatophytes. And these are different kinds of fungus that could grow on the skin, maybe causing hair loss or like ringworm, for example, is caused by a dermatophyte. Okay, then I'll put that here because a lot of times people think ringworm is caused by a worm, but actually it's caused by a fungus. It's called ringworm because of the shape that the infection looks. And then plants, none to speak of that cause disease. And then in the category of animals, we will just put parasitic helminths. Now you might think, hey, what about, you know, if someone gets an infection from a tick or something, which a tick is an animal, but actually what happens is the tick transmits a bacteria, and that is how it causes disease. And then the other question that you might have wondered about, when I say parasitic helminths, you might be thinking of like a tapeworm that could be 30 feet long, and why would we study that in microbiology? And the reason that we do is because they're studied in micro because that's how they're diagnosed, is usually through a microscope. Oops, diagnosis usually requires examining feces or blood for eggs or larvae of these parasitic helminths. Okay, so I'm not sure if I'm going to run out of time here with my phone. My memory's always so bad on this thing. But I am going to give you a few other bacteria that you'll probably be learning about this quarter. So I just want you to have them down. So some more bacteria examples, since this is what we really focus on in this class. A bacillus, these are rod-shaped, and Clostridium, if you've ever heard of C. diff or tetanus, those are caused by organisms that are in the Clostridium genus. And they are always rod-shaped, although sometimes they're, you know, like they can look like a tennis racket rod or something. So I'm making them pretty simple for you here. But what's really special about them is they can form endospores. So we call them endospore formers. And I'm going to use a green pen to put these in here like this. Those are endospores. And they allow Bacillus and Clostridium to survive really, really high temperatures and really bad conditions. Okay, then another one that you maybe have heard of is Listeria. Another, it's what we call gram-positive, and that has to do with the cell wall structure. We'll get into that later. And then my very favorite bacteria, Lactobacillus. I eat about 2 cups of yogurt a day. I'm kind of obsessed with my yogurt and where I get my yogurt from and some local dairies and things like that. So I love Lactobacillus. This is one of the considered probiotic or good flora that helps us remain healthy. So actually, although I listed Lactobacillus as a bacteria, maybe I should put it like this. Lactobacillus fights disease, fights back. Because by its presence, it inhibits the other disease formers. Okay, then let me give you a few examples of gram-negative. So some gram-negative. And I use pink for that because that's the way they'll look to you under the microscope. Lots of these that just come in single, they just are like little tiny rods. They don't form chains or anything like that. And a lot of these are names you're going to recognize. So E. coli is a gram-negative rod. Salmonella is a gram-negative rod. Shigella, maybe you've heard of that one. Pseudomonas. Neisseria, if you've heard of Neisseria meningitis or Neisseria gonorrhea. I think I just spelled that wrong. And that one is actually a diplococcus, like this. So see how diplo means two and coccus means sphere. And so Neisseria's arrangement is in two spheres together. And you can see that in the microscope and it helps with identification. So there you have it. That's a little overview of some of the different microbes that can cause disease and some traits that help you tell them apart. Some examples of each.